Hello students, I am Samuel sir and we are in the fifth chapter of our geography portion that is known as natural vegetation and wildlife. We need to study natural vegetation and wildlife because they are very beneficial for us in more than one ways. You know, diversity means variety and biodiversity means variety of life forms, whether they are plants or animals, whether they are reptiles or birds, or whether they are amphibians or bacteria, whether they are plants which are flowering or non-flowering, they all come under one category of living things. So India has got a rich variety of living things and we call that as biodiversity. We have some 47,000 types of plants. Some of them are flowering, some of them are non-flowering. We have some 89,000 species of animals, a good variety of birds and fishes and amphibians. Put together, everything is known as biodiversity, and we are, human beings are also one part of it. And directly or indirectly, human beings benefit from that. The plants that we cultivate, whether they are crops or orchards, they are not taken into consideration as natural vegetation because they have been planted by us. But the plants which community which has grown naturally without any human aid and they have been left undisturbed for a very long time, such plants are known as natural vegetation or virgin vegetation. This is one of the definitions in this chapter. You should know this. Now some more terminologies are endemic and plants. You know, the plants which are purely Indian, which means they belong to this Indian subcontinent. They are the natural species of the Indian subcontinent. They are the endemic plants. Exotic plants mean just opposite. They are the ones which do not originally belong to the Indian subcontinent, but have been brought from outside and have been cultivated here. They are the exotic plants. When we say flora, we use the term to show all the plants of a particular period and particular region. We are not talking about some other region and we are not talking about some other period, and we are not talking about some extinct plant also. Maybe it was in existence some time ago in the same region, but now it's not there. So we are not talking about that. Similar is the case for animals. We use the term fauna. And this term means the species of animals of a particular region or a period. This is an example of an endemic plant. This is an endemic animal. It's not found anywhere else in the world. Only in India. This is Broantlered deer, and it's found in Meghalaya only. On the other hand, this is an example of an exotic plant. Arum lily is endemic to India. It's an exotic plant to India. And they are originally from Southeast Asia. This is an example of an exotic animal species. This is a giant African snail. Look at the snail size on the palm of a person's hand. It has become like a pest in India in the moist climates, in the Malabar area, in the Western Ghats. And the problem is it doesn't have any natural predator. So this has become a real problem to India. Now the factors which are responsible for diversity in flora and fauna are, when we say relief, we talk about land and soil. And when we say climate, we talk about the temperature, photo period and precipitation. Now the nature of land influences the type of vegetation. And the type of vegetation has got a connection to the type of animals which are living there. So the type of land influences both animal species as well as plant species. There's a variety of terrain which are maybe mountainous, there are plateaus or plains and dry regions, arid regions, desert regions. Then we have the wet regions, and every type of land has its own type of flora and fauna, and this causes the land relief to give rise to diversity in plants and animals. When we say our soil, different, you know that you have different type of soils in India. We have the black soil, we have the red soil, In the yellow soil, we have the alluvial soil, then we have the desert soil, mountain soil, and so on. And these soils support different varieties of plants. And the plants, the variety of plants influences the variety of animals in that region. So we can say that soil is also responsible for biodiversity. When it comes to climate, the first thing in that is the temperature. Along with humidity, precipitation and soil, they determine the type of vegetation. With increasing height, there's a fall in temperature. This is known as lapse rate in geography. And this also brings a diversity in plants and animals. When we're talking about precipitation and soil, you know, when you go higher up on a mountain, the soil depth reduces and the fertility of the soil reduces. Its capacity to hold larger tree is reduced. So you'll find only weaker trees and trees which can survive in cold conditions and trees which are all right with less nutritious soil. Such trees are found higher up in higher altitudes. So based on temperature, vegetation zones can be divided into four types. You have the tropical, subtropical, temperate, and alpine type. Now, photoperiodism is a term in botany, in biology. And this means the duration of sunlight in a day. The duration of sunlight in a day influences the flowering property of plant. Now, trees grow faster in summer due to longer duration of sunlight. And duration of sunlight is caused due to differences in latitude, altitude, and season. That explains the presence of different types of plants in different areas. Now, precipitation means rainfall or snowfall or sleet or hail. And areas with heavy precipitation naturally have a denser vegetation cover as compared to places which are having less rainfall. Now, try to understand photoperiodism by this diagram. On the left hand side, the three vertical diagrams, the yellow portion denotes the daylight length and the gray portion denotes the length of night time. So short day plants are the ones which will flower when the daylight duration is less. Like the middle picture, the one which is showing the rose, the yellow portion is less and the gray portion is longer. Now such plants, if the night time is it's disturbed, if there are flashes of light in the night time, then these plants will not flower. And contrary to that is the long day plants. If they get a longer duration of daylight, they will flower. And if the duration of daylight is shorter, as in the middle picture, blue side, then these plants will not flower. And these plants, they will flower even if the nighttime darkness is interrupted with bright light. So this species and this property of plants is known as photoperiodism. So depending on the duration, the length of daylight, that influences the plants of a particular region. Now, when we say precipitation, we have from top left and clockwise, we have hail, we have rainfall, we have sleet, which is like frozen raindrops, and we have snow. Now, are forests renewable? Yes, forests are indeed renewable. And when you give them a chance, they grow back again. Now, all this facts which I am telling you, which you already know to some extent, you should be able to write that in examination, putting everything logically and in the correct manner. Yes, forests are renewable. Now, this forest, incidentally, burning is renewing this forest. You know, there are some forests which are benefited by burning. It's surprising, but that's true. Now, importance of forest, we all talk about it, we write essays about it, we enter poster competitions and whatnot. But more important than that is for you yourself personally to understand the importance. They modify the local climate. If there is a forest around, the climate of that region becomes neither too hot nor too cold. It becomes a comfortable climate, and they control soil erosion because the roots are holding the soil. They regulate stream flow because the water's force of flowing is reduced when they encounter the plants. They support a variety of industries, for example, rubber industries or honey industry or a lot of medicinal plants. They are derived from the forests. They provide livelihood for many communities. Many communities are directly they're depending on the forests, whether for animals or plants or for medicines or for herbs. They are depending on the plants, on the forest directly. So we have timber, that is the wood we get. It provides habitat to plants and animal species. It gives us food. Most importantly, they act like lungs, and the forests act like lungs. They take in carbon dioxide and they give out oxygen. They clean the air and they also control soil erosion. They offer panoramic and scenic views for recreation. If you want to go for relaxation, if you want to go on a trip, on a tour, go to a forest area, spend quality time of your life there. They control wind force and temperature, and this causes rainfall. Forests provide humus. When the leaves fall off and it falls to the floor, they are decomposed by microorganisms, and the vegetative matter is converted into humus. They provide shelter to a variety of organisms, and they regulate the quality of air. The causes of degeneration of forests is because of the growing demand for land. So this land usually we take from the forest. We clear forest and we do agriculture there. Agriculture is also important for us. There's a lot of demand for land for industries, and when there's a mining activity, it degrades the forest because the forests are cut, the forests are disturbed, the natural cycle is disturbed, the ecology is disturbed. Urbanization also requires land, because if there's a town which is expanding in size, it will naturally take the surrounding land, and often the forests are cut down for that. Overgrazing will also cause degeneration of forests. In our country, we don't have organized cattle animal husbandry. We just leave the cattle to fend for themselves. That results in overgrazing. Now, what's the natural community? In a certain climatic condition, certain types of plants grow in a community. The nature of plant determines the type of animals in that area. So this, the middle point you have to remember all the time. We can say this because when types of plants are changed, the types of animal found there are also changing. So once upon a time, the Asiatic lion, now which are found only in the Gir in the Gujarat, were once upon a time found all over the country. But their habitat has been destroyed. The plant species on which their prey used to survive on, those plants have gone. So those animals, the prey animals have gone, and so the predators are also gone. All the plants and animals form an ecosystem. Because they are interrelated and interdependent on each other, human beings overexploit plants and animals. And when we do that, we are disturbing the ecological balance. Now, what's an ecosystem? You have studied this since standard 5. There's only one source of energy in our solar system, and that is the sun. Green plants have the ability to trap the energy. They do not trap all of it, but they do trap the energy of sunlight, and they pass that energy to the primary consumer, to the secondary consumer, and so on and so forth. At each stage, all of the energy is not utilized. Some of it is wasted, some of it is utilized for some other activities. So this is a diagram of an ecosystem. An ecosystem can be very large. It can be as big as a rainforest, or it can be very small as the fish aquarium in your house. An ecosystem is a large community of living organisms, whether plants, animals, or microbes. They are interacting with non-living components in a particular area. The living and physical components are linked together through nutrient cycles. That is the flow of energy. And ecosystems can be of any size, like you already know. So there's a term called biome. Now what is it? This is a very large ecosystem on land. They have distinct type of vegetation and animal life. Such a large ecosystem is known as biome. Now if you look at this diagram, on the x-axis we have dry to very wet type of forest, and on the y-axis we have very warm to very cold type of forest. Now each continuum will have its own biome, large ecosystem with characteristic plants and animals. Now these are the five types of vegetation found in India. Tropical rainforest, you find that in areas with very high rainfall, and the trees here are very sturdy. The timber they produce is very strong, very durable, and very much in demand. And you have a variety of plants, whether they are just grasses or trees or shrubs or herbs and creepers, they all grow together. And that gives the forest a multi-layered appearance. This is one of the characteristics of tropical rainforest. This is a photograph from a tropical rainforest. Now you have the tropical deciduous forest. When we say deciduous, we mean the trees shed their leaves. So they are found in a region of annual rainfall between 70 and 200 centimeters per year. And they shed their leaves for 6 to 8 weeks in dry summer. Now, depending on the availability of water, these can be either moist deciduous or dry deciduous forest. This is a photograph from deciduous forest. Now, if the rainfall is between 100 and 200 centimeters, such forests we call them as moist deciduous forest. This is a photograph from moist deciduous forest. If the rainfall is between 70 and 100 centimeter per year, we're talking about rainfall per year, annual rainfall, then we call such forests as dry deciduous forests. They are also producing some important, commercially important trees. This is a photograph from such a forest. Now we also have thorn forests and shrubs in areas with rainfall which is less than 70 centimeters per year. We have short trees, we have thorny bushes, we have variety of cactus, we have palm, we have acacia, we have euphorbia. And Rajasthan and Gujarat, parts of Haryana and Madhya Pradesh are examples of such areas. The trees are scattered and they have long root system. The roots, they have the property of collecting water from great depths. And the stem are also succulent or juicy, or they hold a lot of water. This is a thorn forest. Mountain forests are the ones found at higher altitude. This is a photograph of mountain forest. Now in the far distance, when you see the mountain with snow on that, just notice that at a certain height, till certain height, you will find trees. And beyond that height, there are no trees at all. So that height at which you find, beyond which you do not find trees, is known as tree line. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. So depending on the altitude, we have wet temperate forest, between 1000 and 2000 meters. We had temperate forests between 1500 and 3000 meters height altitude. And we have a variety of trees growing in such forests. This is wet temperate forest, and look at the leaves, they are broad. But when you look at temperate forest, the leaves are needle shaped. And with height, when you go to height more than 3600 meter, we have alpine vegetation. The silver fir, juniper, variety of birches and pines are common here. These are the examples of alpine forest species of trees. When you go still higher, the height of the tree gets stunted. The tree's heights reduce. With increasing height, the trees give way to shrubs and scrubs and finally to grassland. At very high altitudes, then you find moss and lichens. So this is a diagrammatic representation. Look at the height at 11,500 feet. The line says it's alpine. And when you go from the foothills higher up, the height of trees and the density of tree reduces. That is because the soil at higher altitudes is not able to support the weight of large trees, number one. Second is the soil there is less in thickness. The number three, the soil there is having less nutrition for the plants because of water or snow. When it melts, with that, the dissolved minerals also flow down. Now then we have the mangrove forests. These are found in the tidal coast, and mud and silt get accumulated on such coasts. The roots of the trees submerge in the water, and often you can find the roots of the mangrove forest jutting out from the mud, or they are often like stilts. And some important plants are there, like palm, like coconut and kevda. Kevda gives us essence. And you can find them in the delta regions. This is a photograph of mangrove plant. Look at the roots. Then we have a variety of wildlife in India. We have some animals which are written on this slide. We have elephants, one-horned rhinoceros, wild ass and camels. We have tigers and lions. India is the only country in the world to have tigers and lions both. And recently, during this lockdown time in Gujarat, tigers used to be not there earlier. Only lions and leopards were there. But that became the only state in the country to have all the three big cats now. Gir Forest is the last home of the Asiatic lion. Madhya Pradesh is known as Tiger State, and Rajasthan is also having a lot of tiger reserves. Ranthambore is there, Sariska is there. Leopards are common and important predators, and India has got sturdy animals in the Himalayas like the Tibetan antelope, Barar, Yak, Kiang, etc. We have some reptiles which are not found anywhere else in the world. Like gharials are crocodiles with a long thin snout, and they are not found anywhere else in the world. Now the advantage of having wild animals is this, that their genes often mixes with the domestic animals' genes, whether it is plants or in domestic animals, and that makes the domestic species sturdy. They are sturdy, they are strong, they are resistant to disease, they give more yield. These are the advantages of having wildlife. Again, a picture showing the biodiversity in India. Now, the steps to conserve our forest and wildlife. This can be asked as a question to you, and you should be able to answer it. The first step is to ban hunting and stop pollution coming from industries. The pollution should not be made to affect, cause its harmful effect on the wildlife and the natural vegetation. Not introducing species that are not natural to our ecosystem. Stopping reckless cutting of trees. We require trees for timber, but we should not just keep on cutting them. We need to plant trees also, and not just on Earth Day, or not just during World Environment Day. We have to keep on doing it all the time. And stopping excessive exploitation of plants and animals. Now, government is taking certain steps. We have 14 biospheres, and we have so many biosphere reserves. We have so many national parks, 89 national parks, 49 wildlife sanctuaries. The government provides financial and technical support to botanical gardens. We have many eco-development projects like the Project Tiger, Project Rhino, and Project Great Indian Bustard, and so on and so forth. These are the 14 biosphere reserves in India. This bird is known as a glossy ibis, and often behind our teachers' quarters we find them. This is the end of the chapter. Give it a thumbs up and wait for the next chapter to come. Bye till then.